Come, come, whoever you are. Come into the circle of love and poetry and justice. Come into the community of mercy, of holiness, and of health. Come, come, whoever you are, and you shall know peace and joy. What we have in the bag are an assortment of leaves of different colors. Had I done this 2 weeks ago, there'd been a greater, brighter array of different colors. The predominance is now brown, but there's some red ones and some yellow ones as well. And where do you think I found these leaves? Yes.
On the ground.
And where were they before?
On a tree.
And so what had to happen to go from a tree to the ground? Yes.
They fell.
And that's why we call this season?
Fall.
Very good. All right. So I'm going to share a poem, but I want to tell you a little bit about poetry. Poetry is one of the oldest expressions of human beings. And it has taken very many forms, and sometimes it's written in rhythms and iambic pentameters and things, which you will study as you get further into high school and college. But I was a poetry major. I was. Which explains a lot of why I'm here now and not in business. And my ancestors come from a county in Ireland called Limerick, which is famous for a certain type of poetry.
Bad poetry?
Some would say bad poetry, yes. One of the things about poetry, in particular having a minister who was a poetry major and has written a lot of poetry, is that I get to share some poetry with you. And so I would like you to hold up your leaves, and I want you to listen to what I share, and I want to see if you can share some movement with the leaves as I read along. It will be very soon. So this is a poem entitled Fall Autumn Waltz. And a waltz is a kind of a dance. So it starts like this. From my kitchen window, I watch autumn leaves dancing after the wind in a quick wind-down waltz. A merry company complete, they twirl and curtsy in rustling gold, rouge, and orange hues. A watercolor whirl, fine as any romance. But soon the orchestra pauses, and each flushed leaf bows refinedly and very low, and then settles on the ground until the music begins again, and another set alights. Some stirred resume the rush immediately, while I, watching behind glass, strain to join in. Were the glass thinner or gone? But I dare not disturb another's dance, so I continue to sit, keeping time with my foot, and enjoy the spectacle. The end. I should also mention I used to perform at the Green Mill in Chicago's Uptown Poetry Slams and got as far as the finals. So I thank you all for listening, and I keep the leaves as a keepsake from today, but also hopefully it will inspire you, because nature is one of the great inspirations for poetry. It has been my custom that most autumns I will share the works of a particular poet, all the better if they have a root with Illinois. And so Edgar Lee Masters and Spoon River, Carl Sandburg today, but other poets, Walt Whitman, Emily Dickinson, we have shared their poetry and learned some of their insights and how they saw the world, how they framed reality through their words. I, as I mentioned to the youth, was a poetry major, not a business course under my belt. but poetry I lived and breathed. And so I believe it is very important to share poetry, to resurrect the bard from time to time, and to let poetry whisper through the air and disturb the silence. And so for today, Jack and I will offer you some of the tidbits from Carl Sandburg, originally from Galesburg. His family, as you may know, was raised Universalist. He attended Lombard College, which was a Universalist school up in Illinois. That school closed during the Great Depression, and so the charter from Lombard passed to my divinity school, and it became Meadville Lombard Theological School. And so I visited his home, the remnants of that college. I've read his poetry. And perhaps you have too, and you will remember how the fog enters on little cat feet, or how Chicago was the hog butcher of the world, player with railroads. Yesterday I visited Barnes and Noble's, because I'm one of those old school people, I like to hold a book in my hands. Not a scrap of poetry by Carl Sandburg to be found, not even his Lincoln biographies. Perhaps it's an aberration. Poets come and go like the tides of the ocean. Their popularity waxes and wanes. And so it is, we are living in a time when the poetry and the vision and the insights of Carl Sandburg are not exalted the way they used to be. And so I think it all the more reason to share some of his poetry and to rekindle an interest in him. And I would invite you to ponder these words before we share poetry along several themes, what he says about poetry. Poetry is the opening and closing of a door, leaving those who look through to guess about what is seen through the moment. It is an echo asking a shadow to dance. He also said, ordering a person to write a poem is like commanding a pregnant woman to give birth to a red-headed child. He also said, when writing, I never made a mistake in grammar but one in my life, and as soon as I done it, I seen it. What we will find in his poetry is that there are many layers. He actually uses the image of himself as an onion. I think that Shrek borrowed that image. And he also said that there are things about his poetry that are surprises even to himself, that he's written poems that even he didn't know what they were about. And he said that's true because, quote, there are 10 people in me and I do not know or understand one of them. Carl Sandburg begins his poetry more often than not in an appreciation of nature. And so one observation he offered is that the moon is a friend for the lonesome to talk to. Likewise, he said, strange things blow in through my window on the wings of the night wind, and I don't worry about my destiny. And optimistically, he said, nothing happens unless first we dream. Specifically about poetry and nature, sunset from Omaha hotel window. Into the blue river hills, the red sun runners go, and the long sand changes, and today is a goner, and today is not worth haggling over. Here in Omaha, the glooming is bitter, as in Chicago or Kenosha. The long sand changes. Today is a goner. Time knocks in another brass nail. Another yellow plunger shoots the dark. Constellations wheeling over Omaha, as in Chicago or Kenosha. The long sand is gone, and all the talk is stars. They circle in a dome over Nebraska.
Between two hills. Between two hills, the old town stands. The houses loom, and the roofs and trees and the dusk and the dark, the damp and the dew are there. The prayers are said, and the people rest, for sleep is there, and the touch of dreams is over all.
One of the themes that pervades throughout the poetry is human beings trying to find their place within nature, and drawing a distinction between loneliness, which is a person who is by him or herself and very uncomfortable, and solitude, which is a person also by him or herself, but knowing that they are accompanied, if by none other than themselves, and are satisfied with that company. So again, on nature and solitude, all day long. All day long, in fog and wind, the waves had flung their beating crests against the palisades of adamant. My boy, he went to sea long and long ago. Curls of brown were slipping underneath his cap. He looked at me from blue and steely eyes. Natty, straight and true, he stepped away. My boy, he went to sea all day long in fog and wind. The waves have flung their beating crests against the palisades of adamant. An excerpt from the poem entitled A Father to His Son. Tell him, referring to the son, tell him to be alone often and get at himself, and above all, tell him no lies about himself, whatever the white lies and protective fronts he may use against other people. Tell him solitude is creative, and if he is strong, and the final decisions are made in silent rooms. Tell him to be different from other people if it comes natural and easy being different. Aprons of Silence. Many things I've said today, and I've kept my mouth shut. So many times I was asked to come and say the same things everybody was saying. No end to the yes, 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 yes. Me too, me too. The aprons of silence covered me. A wire and hatch held my tongue. I spit nails into an abyss and listened. I shut off the gables of Jones, Johnson, Smith, all whose names take pages in the city directory. I fixed up a padded cell and lugged it around. I locked myself in and nobody knew it. Only the keeper and the kept and the hosgow knew it. On the streets, in the post office, on the cars, into the railway station, where the caller was calling, all aboard for blah, 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 and all points northwest, all aboard. Here I took along my own hosgow and did business with my own thoughts. Do you see? It must be the aprons of silence.
A coin. Your Western heads here cast on money. You are the two that fade away together. Partners in the mist. Lunging buffalo shoulder. Lean Indian face. We who come after, where you are gone, salute your forms on the new nickel. You are to us the past. Runners on the prairie. Goodbye.
One of his clear preoccupations has to do with the passage of time. And I think that that's a long-standing motif with many authors, musicians. Just in the feeling that time is passing so quickly and that it's slipping away and we cannot pause it. And so he asks this in the poem, and this will be all? And this will be all, and the gates will never open again, and the dust and the wind will play around the rusty door hinges, and the songs of October moan, "Why, oh, why, oh?" And you will look to the mountains, and the mountains will look to you. And you will wish you were a mountain, and the mountain will wish nothing at all. This will be all. The gates will never, never open again. The dust and the wind only, and the rusty door hinges, and moaning October. And why, oh, in the moaning dry leaves, this will be all. Nothing in the air but songs, and no singers, no mouths to know the songs. You tell us a woman with a heartache tells you it is so. This will be all.
Autumn movement. I cried over beautiful things, knowing no beautiful thing lasts. The field of cornflower yellow is a scarf at the neck of the copper sunburned woman, the mother of the year, the taker of seeds. The northwest wind comes and the yellow is torn full of holes. New beautiful things come in the first spit of snow on the northwest wind. And the old things go. Not one lasts.
Two quotes from interviews by Carl Sandburg about time. Time is the coin of your life. It is the only coin you have, and only you can determine how it will be spent. Be careful lest you let other people spend it for you. And I tell you, the past is a bucket of ashes. So live not in your yesterdays, not just for tomorrow, but in the here and the now. Keep moving and forget the postmortems. And remember, no one can get the jump on the future. Carl Sandburg grew up knowing many a veteran of the Civil War. He volunteered for the Spanish-American War and was stationed in Puerto Rico. He never saw actual combat. But he sat around and heard story after story from the veterans of the Civil War. And then he followed the carnage of World War I. And he saw the catastrophe of World War II and many other wars besides. And it sickened him. And he wondered, what can we say about human nature writ large? Here you have a poet in solitude and other bards, other poets, singing the praises of nature and holding up this vision that time is precious. And what does our civilization respond in kind? Not in kind, but in tears and blood. And so he offers his insights about war and revolution.
And they obey. Smash down the cities, knock the walls to pieces, break the factories and cathedrals, warehouses and homes, into loose piles of stone and lumber and black burnt wood. You are the soldiers and we command you. Build up the cities, set up the walls again, put together once more the factories and cathedrals, warehouses and homes, into buildings for life and labor. You are workmen and citizens all. We command you. Do you remember the title? And they obey.
Among the red guns in the hearts of soldiers running free blood, in the long, long campaign, dreams go on. Among the leather saddles and the heads of soldiers, heavy in the racks and kills, of all straight fighting, dreams go on. Among the hot muzzles in the hands of soldiers, brought from flesh folds of women, soft amid the blood and crying, in all your heads and hearts, among the guns and saddles and muzzles, dreams, dreams go on. Out of the dead on their backs, broken and no use anymore, dreams of the way and the end go on. Optimistically, he also wrote this: sometime they'll give a war and no one will come. But then, to return to the fusion of nature and humanity and civilization, the next poem.
Grass. Pile the bodies high at Austerlitz and Waterloo. Shovel them under and let me work. I am the grass. I cover all. And pile them high at Gettysburg, and pile them high at Ypres and Verdun. Shovel them under and let me work 2 years, 10 years. And the passengers ask the conductor, what place is this? Where are we now? I am the grass. Let me work.
A few thoughts specifically about religion. As I mentioned, he was raised a Universalist. Some of it affected some of his thoughts in later writing. He wrote, to work hard, to live hard, to die hard, and then go to hell after all would be too damn hard. He also said, I won't take my religion from any person who never works except with his mouth. Jesus was a central figure in Universalism of 100 years ago. And the Jesus that he lifts up for his readers very much reflected a human being who was connected with himself and understood the spiritual nature of a human being connected to all other human beings and connected to nature. Not apart from nature, but within nature. And he said, Jesus loved the sunsets on Galilee. Jesus loved the fishing boats forming silhouettes against the sunsets on Galilee. Jesus loved the fishermen on the fishing boats forming silhouettes against the sunsets on Galilee. When Jesus said, goodbye, goodbye, I will come again, he meant that goodbye for the sunsets, the fishing boats, the fishermen, the silhouettes all and any against the sunsets on Galilee, and goodbye, the goodbye, and the promise meant all or nothing. He believed that he was an idealist. He believed that nature at best was indifferent, and that human beings were often cruel and heartless. But it had to be more than that. Because if that's all it was, he wouldn't have written poetry and tried to stir hope and to exalt progress. He did not have a blind eye to all the failings of our civilizations and to the private failings of people. But he always tried to lift up, at some point, enough hope and promise to offset what he saw as the damning indictment through war and poverty and all the ills of modern civilization. Love was one response. Jack will share the next poem.
At a window. Give me hunger, O you gods that sit and give the world its orders. Give me hunger, pain, and want. Shut me out with shame and failure, from your doors of gold and fame. Give me your shabbiest, weariest hunger. But leave me a little love, a voice to speak to me in the day end, a hand to touch me in the dark room, breaking the long loneliness. In the dusk of day shapes blurring the sunset, one little wandering western star thrust out from the changing shores of shadow. Let me go to the window. Watch there the day shapes of dusk and wait and know the coming of a little love.
Perhaps inspired by Mark Twain, perhaps inspired by Will Rogers, there's a comic strain running through a lot of his interviews and some of his poetry. And he offered advice freely. One tidbit of advice is, in these times, you have to be an optimist to open your eyes when you awake in the morning. How shall we find our place in this universe? He wrote, let him seek deep for where he is born natural. Then he may understand Shakespeare and the Wright brothers, Pasteur, Pavlov, Michael Faraday, and free imaginations, bringing changes into a world resenting change. He will be lonely enough to have time for the work he knows as his own. Again, finding one's place, a poem entitled A Fence. Now the stone house on the lakefront is finished, and the workmen are beginning the fence. The palings are made of iron bars with steel points that can stab the life out of any person who falls upon them. As a fence, it is a masterpiece and will shut off the rabble and all the vagabonds and hungry men and all wandering children looking for a place to play. Passing through the bars and over the steel points will go nothing except death and the rain and tomorrow. Speaking also of fences, he said, Scripture tells us to love thy neighbor as yourself. Sound advice, but keep the fences. But one of the most optimistic things that he wrote that I will share with you in conclusion of this larger vision of the poetry and the spirituality, he wrote, a baby is God's opinion that life should go on. From my colleague, the Reverend Kathleen McTeague, may the light around us guide our footsteps and hold us fast to the best and most righteous that we seek. May the darkness around us nurture our dreams and poetry and give us rest so that we may give ourselves to the work of our world. Let us seek to remember the wholeness of our lives, the weaving of light and shadow in this great and astonishing dance in which we all move. So may it be, blessed be, amen.